bucur să văd și figuri, chipuri noi în această sală. Și pentru cei care n-au mai venit până acum în această sală, vreau să vă spun că este un eveniment organizat în cadrul unui proiect care, din păcate, a rămas singular în mediul universitar român, se numește Universitate și Spiritualitate. Înțelegând prin lucrul acesta încercarea de a ne vedea și de a vedea mai bine ce se întâmplă cu noi, cu societatea noastră și cu lipsa de direcție, de scop, de valori și așa mai departe. Avem bucuria de-a lungul celor 4 ani de proiect să întâlnim persoane care au găsit au găsit ceva mai mult decât majoritatea dintre noi în ceea ce privește sensul, valorile și direcțiile și ce avem de făcut, pentru că e limpede că mulți dintre noi suntem în derivă sau cel puțin semi-derivă și ne agățăm de niște resturi sau reziduri de posibilități ca să supraviețuim, dar nu știm ce facem. Proiectul acesta nu întâmplător derivă din Facultatea de Psihologie și Științele Educației și pentru faptul că un învățământ universitar mort în sensul în care profesorii nu sunt destul de vii pentru că ei nu și-au găsit sensul, nu poate să aibă niciun efect și nu e credibil. Am avut bucuria și vreau să-i mulțumesc în primul rând pe Cristian Laivăr, să-l întâlnesc astăzi pe Kassem Zugari și să observ în dânsul un om foarte viu. Un om care emană ceea ce cred că ar trebui să emane orice profesor, nu numai din învățământul universitar, și orice om. O să constatați lucrul acesta și vivacitatea pe care o are este rezultatul unui sens personal. Nu fac decât să vă doresc dumneavoastră, dorindu-mi și mie, să putem să ne resuscităm în fiecare zi, ținând cont de aceste, de un sens. Și sunt convins că întâlnirea cu Kassem ne va ajuta să facem acest lucru. Nu mai rămâne decât să-i mulțumesc Kassem Zugari pentru șansa de a fi întâlnit, lui Cristian Laivăr pentru bucuria de a fi putut să facem două emisiuni TV și să mulțumesc universității și conducerii universității pentru că permite în continuare astfel de manifestări și credeți-mă, dacă aduci în învățământul public vorbești despre spiritualitate, din păcate, și o consideră a fi o preocupare cu iz nepotrivit ștaifului universitar. Sper ca să se devină molipsitoare ideea acestui proiect. Vă mulțumesc și o să-l invit pe domnul Cristian Laivăr să spună câteva cuvinte despre invitatul acestui eveniment.
Bună seara și mulțumesc foarte mult pentru invitație, în primul rând, pentru oportunitatea de a fi aici și pentru oportunitatea de a fi aici alături de sensei Kassem Zugari. Am să încerc să-l prezint nu neapărat ca prin prisma activității dânsului de profesor universitar, de cercetător în domeniul studiilor japoneze, este deja cunoscut. Atunci când l-am cunoscut eu, lucra la acest doctorat, nu știam bine despre acest lucru, eu l-am căutat prin prisma experienței dânsului în arta marțială, experiență pe care am constatat-o citind inițial un set de articole pe care dânsul l-a publicat în Franța. Acestea mi-au atras interesul, era mai mult decât ceea ce scriau cei mai mulți practicanți de arte marțiale. Era ceva greu de exprimat și am încercat să caut acest lucru. Nu l-am găsit atunci în Franța pentru că își pregătea doctoratul în Japonia, dar am avut ocazia să-l găsesc după aceea și ceea ce am găsit a fost mai mult decât se poate exprima în cuvinte, a fost o comunicare non-verbală. Este modul prin care comunică cu adevărat două ființe, la cu totul alt nivel. Și găsim asta și în arte marțiale și nu numai în arte marțiale. Așa cum spunea și el mai devreme, artele marțiale se referă la viață. Mulțumea care nu se referă la viață, ele sunt inutile. Rezultatul acestei întâlniri este faptul că am mers mai departe alături de dânsul și și că acum suntem împreună toți aici. Este doar un, o etapă din această frumoasă întâlnire care a fost atunci. Este o întâlnire, așa cum spun japonezii, Ichigo-ichie. Înseamnă, în japoneză, este o întâlnire care îți schimbă viața, care îți marchează total viața. Și vă mulțumesc tuturor că sunteți aici alături de noi și mulțumesc și lui Kasen că este aici. Thank you very much for being here with us. Deci dacă nu este nevoie de traducere...
Îmi cer scuze, am uitat să întreb. Cine nu înțelege limba engleză? Și asta cât de cât mă refer, că nimeni probabil că nu înțelege dacă nu s-a născut în Anglia. E cineva pentru a elimina traducerea în felul acesta. Putem să lăsăm numai pe sensei să vorbească în engleză? E cineva împotrivă? Mulțumim! Da.
I will be here. They left me alone like that. And after he said he's a disciple. You need to stay by the master, yes. With the master, for the master.
Of course.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. It's an honor to be here, and I thank, of course, the professor and everyone who work hard to invite me here. Student of Christian as well, and everyone here. So, I have prepared a lot of things, PowerPoint, scroll, explanation, etymology, history of words, everything, you know, when you do a university class or a class, you have to be methodologic, everything needs to be clear. But sometimes, you know, when you too much by the book, you forget the essence of what it is to give a class. It's to share, to communicate. And the word of, in the word communicate, you have the word communion. So whatever you Christian, Jewish, Buddhist, Muslim, or whatever, it's something very important. We should not forget that we are human, and we need to share something. So this is what I'm going to try tonight. And the topic, of course, it's about spirituality. And before talking about too much about spirituality, do you hear me, by the way? You hear me? It's okay? And the accent is okay? Because, you know, French, English. I could speak in Japanese, but at that moment, so anyway, I'm gonna try to explain you something. More than explain you, I'm gonna try to take you with me in a journey, in a story, actually. What happened between a master and a disciple in Japan, and how we can relate it, how it works. If, for example, we look historically, two men from different age met according a moment of the time, and one's gonna transmit something to the other one. It's not, it can be, you know, very easy to explain this, but actually it's very complicated. In the case of the classical martial arts, this encounter always happen in a kind of a chaos. It's during a fight. Or during, I heard a master very famous, I want to kill him like this, I take his fame and I become better than him and I'm gonna have my name. And things doesn't work like that. A young man, of course, a warrior. What does it mean a warrior in the 14th century or the 15th century in Japan? It's a professional killer, someone who already have the experience of the battlefield and have been through different stage of his life. And then he met a man. Older, most of the time, who already have more experience of battlefield, more experience of being betrayed, more experience of being under the service, at the service of a warlord. And when he try him, what happened, he is defeated by that old man. In a way, he can't understand. Both are from the same world, which means the world of using weapon, strategy, tactics, killing, assassination, warfare. And he's younger, so which means he's, most of the time the chronicle presents a man who is between 30 and the master is between 50 to 60. Most of the time what we can see it's 30, you're really strong, you have the muscle, you have everything, and the master is old. But you know, when you reach 60 years old, 70 years old in the 14th, 16th century, it's already a miracle. And when they met together, of course, they go for a kind of match. It's not really a match. There is, if you lose your life, you lose an arm, you lose your legs. And what happened? and the moment of the history where life doesn't really have a price, you know, doesn't really have any meaning, the master doesn't kill the student. He just controls him, put him down. And at that moment, for the right man, if it's his time, something happened in his mind. What the hell? That's the word. What did it happen? How can he make that? Why? And then you create a certain kind of envy. The student want to learn from the master in order to become like him. And from here, at that moment, the journey starts. So of course, most of you have seen movies, have read books, novels about, you know, master and student, how it works, like movies like Karate Kid, etc., etc. It doesn't really work like that. It's a little bit more complicated. The first thing you need to understand is, first, the student will never understand the master during the living, when the master is alive. It's really complicated. Why? First, there is a gap of knowledge, age, and experience. You can see a parallel between how the children can understand the parents. Difficult to understand what the father said or what the mother said when you're old, when you go through a certain different kind of your own life, where you go against the parents, when you start to get rebellion, etc. And I'm sure all of you here, and I said this many times during my class, during my seminar, everyone here, and this is what makes us all the same. Everyone here, and whatever the country, whatever the religion, have heard this phrase from his father or mother. When you're gonna have my age, you will understand. When you're gonna be married and have kids, you will see. And of course, at the moment when we hear this, what we say? It's not the same. Different. Huh? It's not the same time. Huh? We're different. I won't do the same things as you. Yes, of course. Why? A parent sees himself through his children. And a master, the difference with the master and the student is, in order that the master start the transmission, and we're not talking about teaching, you need to understand the difference between the word. There is, of course, if I use French word, there is the word enseignement, like, you know, when you teach, c'est l'enseignement. And teaching, it's not transmission. Instruction, it's not transmission. They are all aspects of the transmission that are different. Explain, here is different way to explain. You can explain by words, you can explain by image, you can explain by experience, or you can explain just with your finger or just by showing something. So you can see that transmission have different aspects. You can use the words, you can use no words, you can use figure, you can use movement, you can use object, there is many ways. And of course, according to the situation. So transmission, if you look very well the word, if we do a kind of analysis of the world, there is this aspect of transfer, to go through, inside, and mission. So you have a mission, you receive something that goes through the individual. It's not just teaching. Teaching, there is different kind of teaching. There is the things you learn when you're a certain age, then when you grow, etc., etc. When you go to school, for example, 90% of the things you learn at the first year of university are useless when you do a PhD. Of course, it depends on the professor. And then when you go for a job or when you have to teach, it's completely different. You know, you have some people who have PhD. They are very good on what they do, but they cannot communicate their knowledge. Some people doesn't have PhD, they have nothing, but they can do in few words everything. And this is the same thing in classical martial arts, it's everything everywhere. You have some parents who's gonna be very present all the time with the children and everything, and what happened, the children can do nothing. Some parents won't be there, but will say just what they can, according what they have at the moment they have it. And then the children, by seeing this, it's all about the individual, all about the individual. So when we stretch back this to the master relationship, you can see that first you can't understand, but you're gonna try. You're gonna try. And how can we understand something we don't know? We have to copy. Do you think a baby or a children ask his parents to explain first the etymology or the syntax or the linguistic of the word? No, it just copy. That's why everyone all around the world are always amazed. Oh, baby learn fast. Everyone, baby learn fast. Why? Because first it doesn't have bill to pay, it doesn't have any problem, they get feed. So the brain absorbs everything, and it's true. When you don't have those primary things around you, to think about that, you can learn a lot. But at the same time, how fast we can absorb and how long we can absorb. It's the same when we grew, it's very difficult to stay at least 30 minutes concentrate on something. I don't know for all of you, but for example, recently I went to a theater to watch a movie. 2.5 hours, sitting like this, watching the movies. To move. So obviously even during the movies, you cannot concentrate yourself, and especially if it's not completely enough entertained. So here you can see the master, how he can keep someone entertained according a certain number of years. To keep entertained, it's also a way to transmit. Because you can't transmit like this. For example, if you talk about the, religion, philosophy, psychology, things which are sometimes, you know, can be very heavy if you look this in an academic way. Something that sometimes, you know, you don't even see the meaning. If you take, for example, some book of psychology now, and they explain all those theory and things like that, you sometimes ask yourself, where is the psychology here? Or same for philosophy, same for religion. So let's come back to something more simple, because actually the relationship is simple, but please, mark my word, simple doesn't mean easy. Everything that is simple hides something very complicated, something very sophisticated. It's the same fact, for example, just to catch the glass, to go and to drink. It looks like very easy and everyone can do it, isn't it? But behind that movement, you have a lot of nerve communication, a lot of muscle work. And if you do it in the wrong way, you might get tired. And if someone talked to you at that moment, how things, so you can see the simple move, the simple things actually hide something very complicated. So the student try to understand the master. He cannot. So what he does, he have only one thing. The first things he had when he's born, it's to copy. And the copy is the primary thing to absorb. So he's going to copy not only with his eyes, because we learn with the eyes, but you need to understand that the body on itself, it's an eye. The image is very important, because we construct ourselves through image, image of the parents, image of the grandparents, and the image has also a flavor, sounds. For example, let me give you an example for that. Here, for example, I bring some scroll. And this is what, for example, a master, after a certain years, when he sees that the disciple is okay, he wrote down everything. Everything. But by everything, mark my words, is everything he thinks you need to need. Everything he thinks is enough. And sometimes for the students, he didn't write everything. Why? Because he doesn't have yet the knowledge. Or for example, I'll just show you how it's writing. So a master is going to take time to write down something like that. It takes a lot of time. First, of course, the master needs to have a brain, because in order to write, you need to have a brain. It's not only just a brain. You need to know what to write according to the situation and for who. So you're going to write something in a certain way, very personal. So the one who's going to read this knows that it's like a kind of direct connection with the master image. When you read this, it's not just Chinese character. It's the image of the master. When you read this, you remember what happened during the practice with the master. You remember seeing things. And that's why copy, it's an art. You have to copy in a way that you always keep the souvenir alive and not dead souvenir. So from this, see, it's just writing. You have, for example, here, Nanakajo no Moku no Ku, so it's pretty much like the seven article index technique. Well, when you read this like that and you translate like this as it is, it doesn't have any meaning. But if you take another tone, the tone of a master who stay with a student for a couple of years, 20 years, every day, you should read this like this. Be aware of the seven article I told you. Do you remember? It's the same things. And sometimes it's writing kuden. Kuden means oral teaching. It's something that comes from the Buddhism. The Buddhism tradition. And this word kuden, you find this in many scrolls. It doesn't really explain, they just put a name of a technique that sometimes have no relationship with the practice itself. Sometimes it's a beautiful name, but you don't know what it means. So and then when you know what it means, you see that there is no relationship with the way of using the body. just a name because the master loved that name, he loved the literature, maybe he had a woman at that moment, he was watching the clear moon and, oh, the clear moon technique, I love it. And he wrote it. If he doesn't know, if the student doesn't know all the story behind the white clear moon technique, that at that moment the master met a girl and he wanted to marry it with, he won't be able to read this. For him, it's going to be, oh, why? The moon. What does he mean by the moon? What does he mean by the moon? And for years, his mind search, what does he mean by the moon? And forget that he needs to use his body and that the master is just a human like him. He can be touched. He can be lead by certain envy. And that's a very important to understand. So that's why students, when he copies his master, he copy the way it is, the way he interact with people, the way he is in his life, when he's hangry, when he's starving, when he has problem, when he need to sales, when he need to entertain. The way he show a technique in an A period will be different in a B period and a C period. That's why you need to be with him, because a master, when he teach, is also evolving. He's in evolution. So it is very difficult to teach something fixed. And especially in the case of classical martial art or ninjutsu, where the goal is always to get flow, to be in time, in phase with the changement, to be part of the changement, to become the changement, because the body is based on changement. And this is very difficult. So how can you write down things that needs to be always in motion? Because everyone knows when we write down some things, most of the time we have, it's like we crystallize them. It is beautiful, but it's just words. So you need to use the body. And at the beginning, the only words is the movement, how you use your body for moving. And this is what's going to become, bring the master and the student closer and closer, closer and closer, closer and closer. Until the day, the master is going to use one word to express his teaching, his transmission. We call this Ishin Denshin. In Japanese, Ishin Denshin means from my heart to your heart, from my soul to your soul, from my mind to my mind, which means I don't need to talk anymore. You feel me, you read me. See, it's like, for example, when you love someone, before he served the coffee, you serve before, oh, wow, you read my mind. No, because for one moment we were in phase. So in classical martial art, this is very important. And for the master to find that pearl, he needs to open the door to 10,000 students, because it's only for one. And that's something very important in the classical history, in the classical martial art history, whatever we call this, bujutsu, heiho, ninjutsu, kenjutsu. There is this aspect of ishi soden, ishi soden. Ishi in Japanese means one child, one individual. Soden, it's the transmission. So it's one transmission for one. So it's a unique transmission for one, because at the end there is only one successor. Many disciples, but only one will be on the top. Of course, this will never go without any tragedy, jealousies, etc., because this is what human is. But the good things in case of the classical martial, back in the days, I mean 14th century, the stronger win. And no one talk, a little bit like Game of Thrones, for the people who watch the TV show. And this is what is very crucial, because sometimes you might have five disciples and you love them, like a father can love five, or mother can love five of the children, but there is always one who have something special. Maybe because he's the first one, or maybe because he's the last one. The middle one, maybe, you know, he never had chance most of the time. But from here, you can see that no matter what we have love, there is always, you know, one we love better because he has something in his heart that the other doesn't have, or because one can please us the best way, or someone who will always think about the papa and the mama, always call, whatever, you know. It's the same, really same. Then on his journey, the master is gonna die. It's logic. And he's gonna say to the student, I told you everything I knew. Now it's time for you to open a new line, a new generation, something where you can go more deeper. And the student say, I'm not ready for it. Say, no, are you ready for it? And let them tell me a story that I've seen. One of the masters I've met in Japan, its name is Hatsumi Sensei. When he met Takamatsu Sensei, he's 27. You know, 27 years old nowadays, with a body completely, let's say, already influenced by more than 20 years of judo, 70 years of karate, many different styles. So it already shaped the man, shaped the body. And when he met Takamatsu, so the master is going to follow, so he was 27, and the Takamatsu was already 70. And here's something happened. This is the things we have in the whole history of classical martial art. 70 years old man's gonna try to talk to someone how to change his life. And Hatsumi Sensei said that I died when I was 27 years old. When I met that man, the man I was before died. He was diabetic. First, the doctor said to him he's gonna die. Physically, he was not very good, was fat. Technically speaking, he loved martial art. He had something for that. But when he met Takamatsu Sensei, it was another world. He met a man who was at the same time a philosopher, thinker, writer, artist, anything, study religious, everything. And 70 years old, moving like a cat. Never saw someone moving like this. He is 27, you're strong, you have everything, you have so many medals. Hatsumi Sensei, champion here, practice with all the top, and suddenly an old man, you know, pretty much like Yoda in Star Wars. That's the only thing you can do. And Bim, put him down in a way he never expect. He saw him with a kind of flexibility. He said, come on, this man is 70, he's more flexible than me, the 27. No way. Anything he did, anything he explained was like a world he never saw. So he stayed 15 years with him until he died. And this master, you need to understand, teaching at 70 years old is not like teaching when you're 30 or 40. There is a moment where you're ready. And you don't decide when you're ready to activate the transmission. Something needs to happen. You need to go through a lot of what I call the human life. Tragedy, be betrayed, trust and be betrayed, love and be frustrated, everything. Then at the moment you think it's over, because Takamatsu Sensei was thinking he's gonna end up the nine Ryuha and finished everything. Said, no one. It's like this, it's over. Someone arrived, a young guy, who obviously could not understand him, even in the talk, nothing. He told me many times. I asked him, Sensei, do you understand? Do you understand him when he showed you this? Not a clue. He said, what is it? I was staying like this. He said, why? I was scared. The man was scared. But he was nice. All right. And it's true. The man have a life. He has a life. Let me talk about Takamatsu Sensei. Takamatsu Sensei is born. He never knew his mother. His father was a kind of businessman back in the beginning of the 18th century. A businessman in Japan is more like a kind of criminal, more or less, back in the days. He used to have a two factory where he just have children and women works for him. So you can see, kind of slave, if you want. And he was the kind of man when, for example, you need money to raise a party or to become politic, this is the man you call. So, like you can see, a kind of a gangster or whatever. And he had Takamatsu Sensei with his first wife that she died, and he had seven different wives after that and many children. No one of the wives took care of Takamatsu Sensei, so he was very young and always desperate and beat up a lot. Very, you know, most of the time when you are like this, 90% of the case when you grow up, you're not a good man. Can't really take care of children, you might even repeat what happened. It's the opposite. He went to his grandfather who taught him martial art, escaped in China for 10 years because he didn't want to. He had a kind of big argue against his father because he removed his mother and grandmother as well. And what happened, he stayed in China. He did many things over there. What he had to do for survive, and also to open his mind to different culture. The man back in the days could speak French, German, and Chinese, and he studied a lot. And of course he did things, he had to face a certain situation where he had to kill people. When he came back in Japan, 10 years after, he decided to get into religion, and he go deep. Then he married a woman, But the woman said, don't stay too much on the region, you're going to become a pervert. Because in Japan, most of the monk are synonym of pervert most of the time. And she was scared that he become like that. So he quit for her. And he adopted two children, and he took care of them. And the man was, he teach to everyone, giving help to anyone. So the man, in a certain way, as a man, succeed. But always, he had to talk martial art. He needs to find the one. And the one he find was not from his family. It was someone that live in the Kanto area, so the area of Tokyo, because Takamatsu was living in the area of Kyoto, completely different culture, mind, vision of life. So this is what Takamatsu says, someone who went through the fire and never forget his soul. And he see that young man who lost his father and start to teach him. So he said, I was scared. And each time he was doing a technique, I always felt I'm gonna die. Really? And why you came back? Because I was scared. So I drink a lot and I come back. Good. That's how Hatsumi Sensei was. So he stayed 15 years with him. During those 15 years, Hatsumi Sensei was doing the equivalent right now of 10 hours flight. So he used to take the night train every Friday night, 10 hours back in the days. Stay the full weekend in the home of this master, get pain, learn, study, come back on the Monday morning in order to open his clinic, because he was a bone sitting doctor, working and practice, then like this 15 years. And he received every day, every 3 days, letter from Takamatsu Sensei, tell him, don't forget to practice like this, don't do that, do this, eat this, do this, you will understand, do this. And most interesting, even in the technical side, all the technique of martial art, Hatsumi Sensei could not do it. Even after 15 years after the master, he could not do it. And there is, I just find recently, a year ago, a little bit more, 8mm movies, filmed 1 year before Takamatsu Sensei died. Takamatsu Sensei died 82. During this 80mm movies, there is a demonstration where we can see the old man and Hatsumi Sensei. And you can see that the form of Hatsumi Sensei, but it's impossible. I mean, he gave him the title of Soke and everything before. It's like, for example, you prepare the woman, the house, the children to a man, and he's not yet ready to be a man, a husband, etc. He have everything on his hand, but doesn't know how to do it. So he teach him like that. And when you look this film, you can see, no way, how he could make it. How this man, after 15 years, he could do nothing. Actually, the true practice starts when the master dies. Yes, because when the master dies, it's like when, for example, you move away from your home, from your family home. At that moment, you start to understand the value, because you're on your own. And this is the moment where your education, everything you learn, everything, make you, it's gonna make you, push you to take the right choice. You're gonna make, of course, you're gonna encounter a lot of people, you're gonna meet a lot of people, you're gonna see a lot of things, but the only way to understand the value of your country, the culture of your country, the value of your parents, the price of your parents, it's once you take distance from them. And when they die, it's even more deeper. So when Takamatsu Sensei die, this is when the true practice starts. First, you know, you're at home. The master said, do like this. It's all good. When there is no one to explain you how to do, how to work, how to eat, there is no this voice. This is the moment where you have to recall inside all those souvenirs. And this is, for example, all of you, I'm sure you have experimented this. You're at home, you find picture, you know, like that, old picture of people you love, parents, maybe they're still alive or not. And you are on those pictures, you know, you are on those pictures. And when you see those pictures, it's like there is a gap. There is a moment, the moment stop. The time stop. You watch this and it reminds you, even maybe if there is a music, if there is a smell, if someone fell, you can even explain to the people around, you know why this picture was taken? Because there is this. It reminds you a lot. And this is like that. It brings you the memory back. And the more you practice, that's why, the practice in Japanese, the word we use in Japanese, it's renshu, tanren. They all have this idea of repetition. You can even apply this into religion. Why we pray so much? To not forget. Why we need to read? To not forget. Because you may forget. We forget. We forget fast. Sometimes too fast. Very fast. And because of that, we need to study again. We need to read again. I mean, how many of you here, I mean, personally, as far as I'm concerned, I love to read again and again the same book, to watch again and again the same movie, and to listen again and again the same sound. And it looks like strange, but because there is something on this that called me back, that pulled me back to somewhere, to a place. We are all nostalgic in a certain way, but we need to take care of the nostalgia. Nostalgia, can you bring back, you know, you cry? No. It needs to bring back to square one, where you learn something, where you were innocent, where he touched you, in order to polish this. And that's the idea, to polish, to make it more bright. So when the master died, the transmission starts. The true transmission. First, you have the live transmission, but you can't understand it. Why? Because it's impossible. The master is there. He's explained you, and he knows. And one of the phrases that Kama Sensei used to say to him, said, which means, it's okay if you cannot do it. It's okay. It's okay. It's all right. A master, like a father, like a mother, will always be positive and say, it's all right. Everything's going to be all right. Even when they are sick, when they know they're going to die, say, it's all right. You're going to make it. Because their job is to push. And a teacher, an instructor, a master, no matter what, even in the university, it's to push. I don't know where, but you need to push. Yes, because you can, you know, the direction you have is not the direction of the children or the students. And maybe they can take your direction, but at the same time, you know, push the direction you show to them. There is a phrase, very interesting, you know. Very interesting. Most of the time, you know, parents are born for an area, not the area for the children. And the children are born for an area which are not the area for the parents. But each other can match for one moment to move forward together. And that's very important to keep this in mind. This is what the master does. The master is here to help, to push, to give the direction, the orientation. And at the same time, to show him a quest of meaning. And he said, that was my quest of meaning, and I end up here. Show me where you can go. He show you the door. He clean the door. He give you the keys. He show you how to put the keys inside. He said, and behind, it's wonderful. Work. Work the keys in every way. If it doesn't work like that, check the doors in every angle. Study it from every opening, and then get in. Once again, what I did for you, you're going to do it for someone else. But you don't know when. And of course, the student, how will I know? How will I find a new one? You will see by yourself, like I find you. You will find me, you will find one. And how it works is, it's not something you can fix, not something you can predict, but something you can feel in the air, something you can sense, something you can measure. Why? Because you recognize yourself on someone in an easy way. Why? You recognize the hardship, you recognize the pain. We are all the same in the front of the pain, in the front of happiness, in the front of this, because we all aim for, most of the time, the same things, even if we are violent, not clever, or whatever. Here, what is very interesting about the master and the student, that you're going to push him, you're going to give him everything and even more. You're going to explain him what never been explained to yourself, because you want him to be armed, to be, in a certain way, weaponized for the future, because he's going to have to face the same problem, but in another situation, with another time, with different media, if I may say, with different mind, with things that goes faster in a time of the where the world is here now, everything moves fast. Information is fast. We have information at the tip of the finger. Every iPhone, every smartphone can use many things. But how deep we know information? How can we sense the information? How can we measure the information? I like to translate the word information in this way. In for insight, and formation to formate the inside in order to face the outside, in order to be like that kind of big antenna that take a lot of information, because the inside is ready, because the inside is on process to learn and to practice, you can measure what you receive in a certain way. And for this, it is very important to never forget the body, because the body on itself is a brain. We have a tendency to think that the brain does everything. It's true, the brain does a lot of things, but you know, there is a lot of things that goes through the skin, through the air, through the smells, through the movement. 90% of the things, we even talk by using some mimic, some face expression. When we lie, when we love. I mean, if you just... It's annoying. Someone with no expression, you don't stay with him. No expression means no life. But look, dead people. Some have good face, means... and some... scary, huh, when you look at this. So, by this, like again, to come back to this topic of the master and student, you can see that it's not just about technique, but it starts with the technique. It starts with something that you can touch, something that you can feel. Something, by feel, I mean pain. It creates something inside you, even create the envy. It's a feeling that you see that touch you deep down inside. And you have this in all the relationship, not only between a master and a disciple, but you can have this between the professor and the protégé, and the mentor and the protégé. There is a moment where you teach to the one. Another one where we grew, and this is the best moment, is when each learn from each other. There is like the beautiful connection. And there is a moment where you need to move out because you don't agree anymore, because this is your life, this is mine. And there is a problem of age, a different vision. This is the moment where, for example, in the case of the classical martial, in the case of the parents, it's the moment to be open. It's the moment to not let the emotion lead the path, but the logic or the reason, or the logic with the reason, because sometimes people are logic but not reasonable. And sometimes have the reason, but the reason more with the ego than the reason with no ego. And that's very complicated, especially in the world again of classical martial art, where the ego is really strong, because it's a world of strength, a world of showing your strength, the world where you have to always prove yourself. And it is good in a certain way because you have to challenge yourself every day, but the problem of the challenge sometimes, it brings you to overestimate yourself and to forget humbleness. That's the reason why here again the image of the master, like the image of the parents, is very important. Imagine if you study with a professor which is very good. Many PhD, Harvard, Cambridge, La Sorbonne, not anymore, but any great university, all right? He has so many PhD that more than the page of any kind of dictionary. The man is good. You ask a question, you have the answer, and more than the answer. But he has a big ego. It's only him. And he doesn't help you, he humiliates you. Everyone, at least in his life, have met a kind of professor who is not really a professor. He wants to become a professor for the statue. A true professor, like a true master, doesn't want to be a master, doesn't want to be a professor. His knowledge, his talent put him in the position where he had to. And then he has a duty, not a duty toward himself. First, the duty toward the art or toward the discipline. Because he learned something, he need to give back. He need to give back because life is give and return. You can fight against that, but it's impossible. It's like this. Second, he have a duty toward the fact that he have studied and practiced very hard. So he knows that the practice, the study is hard. Because he knows this, he needs to be merciful. He needs to be hard, very hard against himself, but nice and open to the people, because he's aware of the weight of the knowledge, he's aware of the weight of the responsibility. So he won't put the responsibility to anyone, only the one who has the shoulder to feel it. So he's going to help people and see. He needs to help, he needs to accompany, to be with, to listen, to try to help him for the best he needs and not for himself. I know a lot of professors sometimes say, you should study this area, this is good. Actually, because he wanted to do it, but he didn't have time to do it. So like this, when you do it, then he can sign his name. Come on. A professor is like a father. He needs to be proud that the students, that the kids will be better than him. If you do it just because you want to be, you become a slave, and there's a lot of masters like this in Japan, unfortunately in China too, because they didn't get rid of the envy of being something. So it's like university, of course, name is important, but the university is made by the people who are in, by the student. Knowledge doesn't have any frame. Knowledge is knowledge. It's for everyone. It's open to everyone. Once a master understands that, he understands humbleness, because there is always someone who knows better, who have better. In, for example, in religious studies, any kind of religious book, commentary of Bible, or Kabbalah, or Torah, or Quran, always start by, God knows more. Just by saying this, it's understanding that intellectually you have a limit. When you recognize that you have a limit, it's the beginning of humbleness. And it's the same, when you read the scroll at the end, I mean, that's something very interesting. In the European system, when they start to bring martial art in Europe, starting by France, I'm sorry for that, and because we made a mess, and UK, and you need to understand that what happened, for example, after in Spain, Italia, Romania, and all, I think Germany and Holland, maybe a little bit an different example, but when you look the history, for example, in case of France, when they bring something from outside, they need to make it French. I don't know why it's in the culture. They need to franciser. So they're going to say, we teach you the traditional way, but in a French norm. We call this la norme française. So you're going to teach a foreign culture in a French way, and I still have a hard time. I still have a hard time with this, because when you read, for example, a book made by high-class scholar in religious studies, translation of the primary translation of the Bible from Latin, first Arabic, Greek, Latin, then after French. Same for Hebrew for the Torah or Quran. They most of the time said, it took me 20 years to stay with the people, like it can be Arabic or Jewish, etc., in order just to have the same habit as them, to talk like them, to understand their feeling. And after that, I have tried to give you a glimpse of the sense of the text, because translating is betrayed in a certain way. And this is the humble approach when you want to teach. You already show. Yeah, of course, on the book is huge. You can see the notes, explanation, but because you have, you have to give more and more information in order to make it ready. And that's very important, what I mean to say here. It's how can we ourselves study, practice just for ourselves? It's a waste of time, honestly speaking. If you do something, if you practice something, it's to give. And the master, a true master, is a man who understands that, is a woman who understands that. It's someone who goes deep, someone who's going to show you the way, the orientation, and the destination at the same time. But the destination is not the end. It's just the beginning of something else. And I'm going to finish now. And if you have any question, because I need to finish the destination, and you need to ask questions. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. If you have any question, please feel free to ask. Thank you very, very much. If you have any questions, feel free. I don't bite. Please, no problem. It can be on martial art, on Japanese culture, lead with a master-student relationship, what we call Shitei Kankei in Japanese. Shi, it's the master. Tei, it's the student, the disciple. And Kankei is the relationship. And just for finish, as you can see, I'm sure in Romanian language it's the same. You have different words in order to show the different stage of a discipline. For example, you have in French, écolier. It's the one who goes to school. School boy, if you want, school girl. Then there is a collège, I'm going to say collégien, collégienne. Then there is a lycée, lycéen, lycéenne. Then here's université, étudiant. See, but étudiant, like a student, is the one who study. A disciple is the one who discipline himself. Followers is the one who follow. Doesn't mean he uses his brain. But as you can see, you see each word, you know, using the brain is very important. And I forget to tell that, you know, when you stay with the master, you need to question the master. It is logical to question the master like a student, like a children question the parents. And sometimes the question is embarrassing. So you need to find a way to answer anyway. You need to use anything in order to deliver an answer. The problem is, maybe the answer won't fit and he won't be happy with the answer, but you know, the answer is not here to please. It's an answer, like for the question, it's not here to please. So you are a master when you can use any, or a professor or an instructor, when you use any kind of thing to help the student, to push the student, and sometimes even against himself. Sometimes you have to help him even against himself, and that's the worst part, because he might don't get it, but you need to do your job, you need to do your duty, you need to deliver the message complete, and then after it's all about him. And I'm going to finish again with Wim Fink, and I will take the question after. The kanji, the character for transmission, it's in Japanese, tsutaeru, tsutaeru. And when you wrote it, it's very interesting. You have the first part means the man, and the second part means to talk. So if we do the etymology and analysis of the kanji, transmission in Japanese means a man or a woman, a human, that talk, that speech, that say something, that deliver a message. All right? And this is very interesting about the transmission. I said it's a mission that goes through you, through your brain, through everything that goes beyond you. And this is very important. Once the message is delivered correctly, rightly, precisely, that's the duty of the master. The duty of the student is to understand it. The understanding of the message doesn't belong to the master. If he did his job correctly, no matter what, someone will come and pick up. That's why there is book. That's why what we learn today will be different tomorrow, and someone from another country, someone who loves, for example, the Roman culture and the Roman history, sometimes you have foreigner who can teach you your own history and your own language better than you. Same for anything. That's why there is always, don't, and please keep my word, that the message, once it's delivered, the way to understanding depend on you. And of course, you had everything, you had access, you saw the man doing, you've been witness of the moment when he did it and why, and the reason why. If you don't practice, if we don't study, which means if you don't use your brain to remember how the parents were cool and nice, where the food was always on the table, etc., etc. If you don't use your brain to remember what the professor said at that time and the reason why he said, and to question the context and the reason why, you won't be able to understand the message, and actually you will lose the message. But it's okay. There is always someone else. That's what we call the human chain. That's why we need human. That's why we need each other. Thank you very much, and now you can ask questions. Yes, please.
In the 1800s and the beginning of 1900s, why the message the master wanted to deliver was using the religion vessel, and was using the religion?
All right.
I mean,
do you have something specific, a style, or?
Yes, I do. I do. Aikido. Yes.
What you need to understand, first, the word religion. Now we're talking about Japan, and when we talk about Japan, it's very difficult to use the word religion first. Yep. Because when we talk about religion, of course, from the Latin religare, which means to be linked, it's something that most of the time include the free monotheist. which is Judaism, Christianism, and Islam. In Japan, it's a little bit complicated. We have this kind of syncretism where Buddhism and Shinto goes together. Then you have different school of Buddhism, etc., etc. So what you need to understand first is before that, because if I answer to that, and you don't know what happened before, you won't answer. First, all the classical martial arts, what we call the Ryuha, the fondator of those Ryuha, always have been into temple, they stay in temple or sanctuary of Buddhism and Shinto, where they've been touched by certain monk, the way they do that kind of ascetic practice. And they use this in order to reach a certain level. For that, they stay in temple for a week, a month, fasting, cold shower, practice every day, and pray in order the kami give them a kind of inspiration. And every ryuha is about that. In order, in a certain way, to legitimate the practice, to give us, because you know that weapon, it's for kill. So you want to find a way to use the weapon in the right way. And that's very important, all right? Very important to keep this in mind. And about the period you talk, it's just because of an individual. It's Ueshiba Morei, the founder of the Aikido. Since his youth, he was really attracted by mysticism. Doesn't mean he was clever. Actually, we know a lot of things. There is the image of the master and the reality, and it's completely different. And there is also what the foreigner wanted to believe about him, and it's completely different from... The man was really, really attracted by mysticism, but he was not really bright, never went to school. His father was bright, had a lot of money, but the son dilapidated all the money for martial arts. Not that cool then. And he was thinking he was really strong, like most of the masters at the time. And he met, when he was in Hokkaido, so North Japan, with the primary primary wave of Japanese who went over there in order to develop the country. He met a master called Takeda Sokaku, fondator, more or less, for some of Daito Ryuha Aikijutsu. And this man was not a religious man, not at all. That guy was a fighter, and he loved money, women, and alcohol. And so for sure, he had no, let's say that, character, you know, as a person, you might don't like your master, but you love what he does. You love the technical part. But the man, nah. He was rude, like that. And Ueshiba was, you know, always, master, no. But he was the master, and he was stronger than him. He always put him down, so. And he learned a lot like that. And then he heard his father. His father was... very ill, and he wanted to go to see him because he felt he's gonna die. What happened, at the time in Japan, you have a lot of kind of sects with people who have power here and there, shaman, who rise here, and there is a man known as Onizaburo Deguchi. And this man, a very clever guy, a very clever guy. When I said clever, clever in everything. He make a kind of small putsch in the Omo Tokyo, married with the daughter of the main shaman woman who have power to heal, married with her, took the place and established himself as the man of power, the man of who talk with the god. So, you know, you need to be very clever, very good in psychology, know how to read people, and to take them at the moment they are the weakest. And that happened nowadays, same things, in martial art, everywhere. And when Ueshiba went to meet him, he just lost his father that he didn't, so he had a lot on his heart. He knew what he did was not good. What did say the man? He said, I saw your father in a dream, he's okay. From that moment, everything Onizaburo Deguchi will say, he will accept like the word of the Christ. And this is the moment where he starts to get a little bit in religion, but not completely. The way he moved, the way he teach was still hard, pretty much straight to the world. things happen when you're getting more old after the war. And here you need to understand something very, very important. After the Second World War, Japan is completely destroyed. Martial arts are not seen by the American government like something good. Actually, they look this like more a nationalist way, which is true because judo, karate, kendo, aikido was taught by all to all the children, all the young people, and with a certain mind, a nationalist mind. So it was used for this. And of course, the student of Ueshiba Sensei were like him. Some of them came, went to war, they killed, etc., etc. So after the war, you want to change. See, you saw a lot, atomic bomb, Ueshiba saw a lot of things too, lost a lot of students, lost children as well. Something happened. And you can see this in many men through the martial art. They are like, for example, very dangerous, they kill, they do a lot of things, and then something happened. They saw too much, and they're looking for a way to purify themselves, or to purify their own action, to change, to redeem. And this is what happened. And that's the moment where I use the word Aikido with the kanji, eye of love, which is strange because most of the students are looking for effective technique. So you can say that love is effective. And love hurts sometimes, not many times actually. So we know that it's more like individual. Jigoro Kano didn't put this in the judo. Funakoshi, the one who brought karate the first time, not the first time, but the one who make known the karate and used the first time the word karate as a word. Before that, he was Tote, Okinawa Tote, or Okinawa Kenpo. Never used this aspect of origin, but he used the do and the karate of from a Buddhist text called Buddhism text called the Anya Shingyo, and that's how we changed. The empty hand come from here. Kendo didn't use any kind of like spiritual things, just the fact of doing Seishin, this aspect of clear your mind that they took from Buddhism, same from Yai, same from everything. The only thing that really used the aspect of spiritual is Ueshiba Sensei once he quit, let's say, the regular life, stay in a Ibaraki Ken where he created the Aiki Jinja, pray every day. And even when you listen his speech, because there is all the tape where you can listen what he's saying about Shinto, and I've talked with professionals of Shinto, they say, what he's saying is crazy. No sense. So, like again, it's depend on individual. Some have a tendency to go to religion. Some, you know, they are very hard. They go more soft, more relaxed. It depends. To my point of view, I think some you can practice both. There is bridge between the two things. Why? Because in both, they use the body like a kind of vector for study, for going deeper in order to push the limit or to understand the limit or to understand your own habit and to control, to learn how to control yourself. This is the, let's say, the connection. Now some people's gonna stop martial art and do only religious. And that happened in the history of classical martial art. For example, the founder of the Itoryu Kenjutsu School, Ito Itosai, after he gave the scroll, he decided to quit martial art and to stay in the temple. In the Yagyu family, they did this too. They changed name, become monk, and doesn't use martial art anymore. So it depends on the individual, like always. Now saying there is religion in martial art, no. Martial art, and especially what we call bujutsu, military technique, it's made for kill. It's war, it's military, it's meant for kill, there is no sentiment. Now, someone who is educated, someone who study, someone who have access to more and practice military art, know how to control, know how to measure, know how to ponder it. I think the religious mind can bring this, can bring light to a place of darkness. That's what I think. Any question, please? I hope I answered enough. Because you know, you ask between 18 to 19, you know, it's almost one century.
Yes, but I wanted to filter, try to filter your response a little bit, because...
Yes, it's wide.
Yes.
Because if I said to you, yes, no, or yes, there is this point, it's not enough.
I was referring to
it's not enough. So, and use the good filter.
Okay.
question, please feel free. Yes?
It's a little bit related to the previous one. It is a common point, common practice for Koryu, old schools between 14th centuries to maybe 18th centuries, to have other practices besides the physical, technical, being with body only or weapons, meaning, you know, like a dietary guidelines or spiritual, you know, possession, being influenced by Buddhism. You know? So it's a common point between the Koryu.
The common point, you need to understand that it's more, I'm going to use things from Buddhism in order to be better on the battlefield. You know, you have to be, for example, everyone knows this story. One day, a master go to see a monk, and they talk. And during the talk, at the moment, the master tried to take, master of war, tried to take his glass, the master stop his, the monk stop his hand. How did you do this? I feel you. I said, but how can you sense my intention? I practice Zazen. So the master is going to practice Zazen. But why want to practice Zazen? He want to practice Zazen in order to be able to stop or to kill before. So you see, it's like you take something which is purely religious, to understand the law of Buddha, etc., etc., to something for killing. There is a problem here. Now what I tried, this is something very common. Using Zen, Zazen, using anything that will allow your martial art to be more accurate, to be more deeper. That's one thing. Or using Mikyo, Kujikiri, etc., etc. This is something that exists in many Ryuha. But sometimes it's also used in order to hide something more complex. Let me explain you about that. There is in Japan, most of the temple or sanctuary used to be protected by a warrior family who devoted their life to a certain kami, like a kami of war, like Hachiman, Bishamonten, etc., etc. And it was a tradition that before going to war, before starting the war, to go always to the temple in order to ask the help for the god and protection. And you have this everywhere. You have this, of course, in Europe. Now, at the end, they try also to always do the battle according to certain rules, to cut the head in a certain rules, yes, to fight according to certain rules, because they were also very superstitious. This is one thing. And between that, you have certain kind of warrior who practice like monk. They practice martial art like monk. They are controlled, devoted to the control and do everything. And when you practice to a certain level, to a certain limit, to a certain extreme, your mind needs to be, how can I say, used. And this is the moment where there is a kind, more than spiritual, it's more like psychological way. You try to read your opponent. See, you try to be available, you need to read his face expression, etc., etc. And then, according who you are, and this is a very important aspect, it's not just about it's who you are, which means if you have in your heart, deep down in your heart, a good heart, a benevolent heart, a heart which is already, you know, a little bit versed, attracted by spiritual awakening. Some master were not. Takeda Sogaku didn't care. There is some Miyamoto Musashi, when you read about this thing, he said, don't believe the Buddha, I pray them, respect them, but don't ask them nothing. And some, for example, like Yagyu Renya, was very important. Each time he tried to control the guy, not to kill him, each time he had to kill someone, he was always crying because he said, why did I practice those heart? Is it for killing? So you always have those two extreme. Some could find the middle, but after a very long journey through the blood and Game of Thrones. So yes, he went like that. But there is a bridge, you know, when you use your body, you use your brain. It's very logical. When you're gonna have to face someone in a shock of the weapon, you can go like crazy, or you can go cleverly and see where there is the weakness. So there is this aspect in classical martial art that you read, Kyo Jaku Jugo Arube Karazu. The meaning is, Kyo, it's the strength. Jaku, it's the weakness. And then you have Go, it's the power, and Ju, it's the flexibility. So you need to understand, you need to study, you need to analyze the substance of what weakness is about. To understand weakness, to understand your own weakness and to understand your own strength. Then to study it and to use the weakness and the strength to know how to shift from one to the other. So this already requires a little bit of what we can call elementary psychology. Then you need to understand the power, how to launch the power, the meaning of the power, when to use the power, and flexibility at the same. Once you can shift to one stage to the other, which means you know your body, it deals with the anatomy, it deals with the emotion, through weapon, through negotiation. Once you understand those four stages, state of mind and body, you don't use them anymore. I'm not yet to that part, that level, but this is where you can feel your opponent and decide to do or not, to control rather than kill, to show him, and let's hope he will have enough brain and heart to understand that in front of him he have someone that it is not good to play with. Sometimes you have to make an example and you have to shut down everything fast. So it depends. Nowadays most of the Koryu use Buddhism, Shinto, Mikyo terminology words in order to explain things. And the people who practice Osuha are not Buddhist or are not Shinto, or confuse both. And this is the problem. You need to put things in their context first, to understand in their context the value of the context. Some master like Kamizumi Senokami, the founder of Shinkageryu, was able to, at the time of the 15th century, not kill and stop. But he reached this after half killing many people, unfortunately. There is a short way, there is a shortcut to reach. It's difficult. History is full of examples. And they understood that it's purely violence and you need something in order to control, to regulate that violence. So Zen, Zazen, Mikyo, then of course Christianism or Judaism or Islam, or just a certain vision of life, a certain kind of ethic of life, a respect of life, will allow you to regulate. So there is no such like a practice, not because you do seishin every day that you can control your mind when you get tired or when you get frustrated. If you control your body, you should be able to control your mind and etc. etc. It's the same for any kind of religion. Now, practice it something, apply it something else. That's the difficulties. Any question, please? Yes, madam.
So from what I've understood so far, we've been talking about the ideal relationship between the master and the apprentice, right? How is that applicable in today's lives in the dojos, where you just find a dojo that's near you and you find the sensei already there, he might be or not?
This is a very good question. You know, I mean, and thanks to remind me, I should talk this a little. You know, in the 15th century, 14th century, until the middle of the 16th and 17th century, there is no dojo. Doesn't exist. Never. The master is the dojo. It's pretty much like when you look religion at the beginning, there is no temple, there is no church, there is no mosque. It's after. After the message is delivered, when you have to explain to people, you create establishment where people can gather it, etc., etc. So first, find a master. It's something. It's not because you find a master that the master find in you the discipline. So you need a little bit of time. So because there is no dojo, you live with the man or the woman every day. So you see in every day. Then when things gonna be established as a dojo, means that the master live. He needs this to eat. He needs this to support his family. So the art, it's not an art anymore. It become a little bit commercial. And at that moment, it's going to be very difficult. Do you teach because you need money? Do you teach because you have to teach as a duty to your Lord? Do you teach because the one who is in front of you is really good? Or do you teach just as a duty because it's your children? Those four questions have started already in the beginning of the 16th century. Nowadays, problem is, dojo, it's a business. It's a business. And I'm okay with it. If the business is done well, in the right way, fair, and to not forget to praise the student rather than ourselves and look the student as an individual, as a human, and not like just a human wallet, it's okay. Problem is, it is difficult as it was in the past, because first you can follow the master, but he might never teach you. The master never teach, you know, you watch him, he show one technique, and maybe if you're very lucky, he might say to you, your hip is too low or too high. No, it's not good. Back in the days, they take you down and said, ah, like this, it doesn't work. And they will never explain, because the lexical word didn't exist. So then it depends on the man, if he's nice, if he's open, if he have a little bit of empathy. It's very difficult. And nowadays, it's even more difficult, because back in the days, you knew, it's fast, it's direct. No, you're not good. Or you die, or whatever. Nowadays, you're right, the man is, oh, you're good. What do you want to train? I can teach you anything. Oh, you can be a black belt in 5 days. Oh, good like that. Yeah, no, it's okay. No, by the way, here's the price. And let's see. And he's a it does communication. It is difficult. So the only things I can tell you here, first you need to study. And you need to trust your heart, not your emotion. Mark my word, you need to trust your heart. When you met someone, don't see if he's smiley, if he's nice to you, because you look nice, or because, no. Look how he treat people, first thing. Look how he treat people and how he behave. Does he, I am the master, you cannot ask me any question, you're not ready. No, I won't answer. Does he, look how he treat people, the way he treat people, especially the newcomer. If he treat people equally, the way he is, when, for example, he teach you, because it's martial arts, about movement, so technique, who hurts? If he want to hurt you in order to show to everyone that he's the best, or if he try to show you how the body mechanics works, the anatomy, look, if you press here, it's like that, take care, don't hurt, look that. Try to read the man or the woman who teach, rather than listening your own envy, you know, to be ranked and things like that. Because most of the time we hear, we want to listen what we want to hear, not what we don't hear. So that's where it's difficult. Nowadays, with everything, with internet, with all the information, it is possible to see that, but not easy, because still, you know, teacher have a power on the student. They have a power, yes. When a student come at the door, it's the same at the university, you know, you're gonna teach to people who have doesn't know psychology, doesn't know anything. So you need to take care of what you're gonna teach them. So in the case of martial arts, when a student come in your door, he bring what he have the more holy. It's his physical and mind legitimacy. You need to take care of that, you see? If you break this, if you hurt him, you're gonna maybe change his brain, and what he's gonna teach is the same stupid things as you did. So you have to be really careful. That's why transmission, teaching, instruct, even explain have a weight. So how to do? Well, I'm going to tell you, you need to meet many people, see everyone, then put this one, good technique, but I don't like the way you look, etc., etc. And then you choose what your heart feel all right. But be aware that maybe what you choose at that moment is good for a couple of years. Be ready to spread your wings and to go to someone else.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Yes,
I have a question. How does a master chooses his student?
Well, it's a lot of factor. He doesn't choose it. Something inside his heart, the situation, make him choose it. It's not like, I'm choosing you, you become my student. Most of the time, after he's gonna betray you, if I knew. And this, we have a lot of story like that. Sometimes, you know, you met a student, it's like you have a friend, right? Friend for life, we play for soccer and everything, we do everything, and one day, he said something bad about you to your best friend, and you don't believe to that. Come on, we're friend. It's the same things. It's difficult to know when this one is, you need to stay. It's a question of quality of time. You need to stay with the people long time and to see him how he's gonna evaluate. And at that moment, there is a different factor that's gonna match in one. You're gonna feel here, you're gonna see yourself through him. It's like that. And you won't tell you, my student. You're gonna make him endure a lot of things and see if he's gonna endure it. And if he endure, that's why you need a lot of patience. In anything, you need to be patient. Even for looking for a dojo and a master, you need to have a lot of patience. And at that moment, he knows that he's the one. My pleasure. Any question, please? Yes.
How should you practice in such a way that you only absorb the essence of what you're doing? Either it is karate or ninjutsu or whatever.
So how do you practice? Well, first you have to copy. There is nothing. That's the first thing. You need to copy. You need to copy, and you need to copy clear. Let me give you the word copyright. I'm going to give you an information of how copyright is in the case of ninjutsu and classical martial art. First, you need a master who give you a copy. So he need to show you. And he need to show you something right, precise, and sharp. Right? Then you need to copy his copy. So he needs first to show you something right, and you need to copy right. You need to copy what he does in a right way, in a precise way, in a way that the two copy match. And then, when you copy right and he give you the right to copy, because of course the master needs to give you the right to copy himself, he can hide. So he give you the right to copy what is right, and because you have copy rightly is right, you have the copyright. And this is very cool. I I'm confused about copyright now. What I want to say to you here is you need to develop the faculty, and you have it, copyright. That's why you go to see him many times and you ask, can you do it again? Can you do it again? If he said no, it's because he's tired. And by the way, he have the right to be tired. He have the right to say no. You know, sometimes there is a moment where he wants to teach and sometimes where he doesn't want to teach. And sometimes you need to give him the envy to teach. You know, it's a relationship. Huh? Of course, he have a duty, he will do it, but the duty is better when you put some sugar inside. Or salt, whatever. It's human, you need to understand. And sometimes when you give him the envy, there is something in you, and this is the same as the previous question about choosing the student, he teach no matter what. You understand or not, he teach no matter what. So you need to copy. You need to make the effort. You need to effort yourself. You need to resist on yourself. Not to wait, he explain everything, because the more he explain, the less you understand. You need to copy and come back and copy and come back. That's the only way to do. Then once you copy, you come back home. You have your copy. You analyze your copy. First you study your copy. And once you study your copy, you analyze your study. Once you analyze your copy, you apply what you copy. And if it doesn't work, come back to ask why it doesn't work. Maybe something. Then you copy again, and you copy again, and you copy again. And the more you copy, the more you practice, the more you practice, the more you polish, the more you go deep, the more you know yourself. Then you have to copy right. You just need to copy. And that's the only way to learn. That's the word. That's the only. You need to copy and learn what you copy. Practice what you learn and learn what you practice. And the more you go deep in that case, the meaning of the word learn, the meaning of the word practice, the meaning of the word copy goes deeper. You need to level up everything you do. If you want to call an art what you do, you need to copy as an art. You need to copy to an art. To level up to the art. So you need to copy every details. To watch everything. Are you gonna ask me how you do this? You open your eyes. You open your eyes. And then if the first time you open your eyes it doesn't work, open a second time. Use YouTube, anything. And if it still doesn't work, do it again. And again and again. And don't do 10 times, 20 times, 20 times and say, no, it doesn't work. Do it all your life. There is a saying. Shisho wo ichinichi maneba ichinichi maneru. 1月生まれば1生まれば一緒になる Translation. If you copy the master one day, you are the master like him one day. If you copy him 1 month, you like him 1 month. But if you copy him all the life, you like him all your life. Now you choose. 1 day, 1 month, 2 days, 1 semester. Copy it or not. I mean, I've met Ishizuka Sensei, I was 17 years old. Atsumi Sensei too. I stayed 2 months in Japan. I didn't speak Japanese. And I could not eat sushi back in the days. I was watching this like that. What is that? I didn't know. The only thing, as far as I know, and as far as I was concerned, was things like manga, Dragon Ball Z. That's the only things I knew about Japanese. I didn't expect. I'm going to do a PhD on Japanese studies, and especially classical martial art. How did I do if after 2 months I came back in France, stay alone 4 years, and come back after 4 years? How did I do? I don't think I'm more clever than you. Actually, I don't think I'm clever. I'm just someone who copy. But I copyright. And he gave me the right to copy. Actually, I took it. It was like this, so I took it. Just copy. There is no methodology for... there is, of course, a methodology to study at school, to make your homework, etc., etc. But in case of classical martial arts, you need to learn to copy. Copy is the first way human being knows to learn. We copy the parents for talking, we copy things, and when we like something, we copy. If you like soccer, you know, for example, even in boxing, any kind of sports, you copy to learn. How, for example, the disciple of Leonardo da Vinci, or any kind of great things, how did they learn? You think he took the time, you need to take the brush like this, perspective cavalier like that? No, he's there. You copy like him, and the one who can do it, the one who is closer, is the one. Sorry for that. You need to copy. And it's cool to copy, huh? You know what? You don't have to think. When you copy, you don't have to think, so you absorb. Huh? All right. In school, long time ago, and that's going to be on YouTube. Not good for my kids anyway. I was not good in mathematics at all. So it happened sometime during the test. And you know, when you copy all, even the mistakes. So, teacher, at the end, tells me, hey, come here. You copy. And of course, I lie. No. You copy. No. You copy so good that you even copy the mistakes. So, don't do this, huh? Anyway, yeah, I went to PhD, I didn't copy for that. But what I try to tell you here, so when you copy, you know, when you copy everything because you rely, you see the man is always good, so he's going to have a good note, so you copy everything because you want to be like him. That's what I want to say. So learn to copy, you copy, and then of course, now that's why with age I said, then study what you copy, you know? You copy, say, hey, by the way, you did a mistake when you wrote that. That happened. And sometimes you have a better note than him. Say, so, well, you copy on him. Yeah, but I study what you copy. Some mistakes. Well, you didn't tell me. Didn't have time. The teacher was watching us. So, things you can use like that.
And yes. When do you stop copying as a disciple?
Oh, you never stop copying.
Never?
No, you always need to copy. You polish the copy. If you stop copying, means you think you reach enough. And when you think you reach enough, this is the ego part of the brain said, you know, I don't need to copy anymore. I can do by my own. And when you have a teacher who is like that, always, when you go to a dojo and you see, you know, some people, they love to put picture first of the master, then picture only of them. So if there is only picture of them, move. But if there is a picture of the master, sometimes for to legitimate what they're doing, then if you listen the way they talk about their master, if they always talk about the master with a big respect, deep respect, and they always put the senior in the front rather than them, it's a, let's say it's a manifestation of humbleness, but be aware of someone who is too much humble too. Yes, the world is not a peaceful place, even if it is. Yes?
I have a question about the, there is a kind of tendency in Japan, and you will correct me if I'm wrong, that a certain masters or the certain high, very famous schools are claiming that their way of practicing is very authentic and it's very applicable, and in practice it's not the case. So it's about a question about authenticity. And in any other schools, for example, like Kuroda family, the Kuroda yes, and another one,
Konoya,
thank you. Yes, and the one, they seem like they don't show themselves too much. They keep it very low profile. But it seems to me, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong, that it's much more efficient and much more.
I will not correct you. I will bring you more information. Okay. You will learn to correct yourself by yourself. Here it is. It is true that the word authenticity is something that we're all looking for, right? Rather than, I mean, what means authenticity in classical martial art? Authenticity, my definition of authenticity, it's something that works no matter what the period, the man you face or the woman you face or the struggle. So if you said you do something authentic and that doesn't work nowadays, it is not authentic. It is just set of movements, fixed, predetermined, in a sports way, even if you said it's not sports way. And you can give me any kind of ryuha, I can tell you and show you just by the way they move that the movement have been lost, changed, adapted because of the so-called knowledge of the master. Now, when you talk about Kono Yoshinori and Kuroda Tetsuzan, and said that they keep low profile, it's not the truth. They doesn't keep low profile. I mean, I live in Japan, they are not low profile. They are known since now 20 years, and they do a lot of things on TV, on newspaper, etc., etc. They are also a part of this kind of big boom of Koryu, how to find the movement of Japanese back in the days, how to use the body in a more special way. And actually, you know, Mr. Kuroda, with all respect, think that what he does is authentic. And he stay in, I mean, like most of the master, you know, they doesn't really do Koryu. Koryu means also exchange in Japanese, to exchange with people. They stay, they doesn't want their student go to learn other style. Sometimes they even forbidden that, maybe question of money, you know, it's better that the money stay at home than you go over there. That's true too. They have a tendency to believe that what they do is the best. When you start to think that what you do is the best and the other one are low level, this is the beginning of the end. And you do this only with your own student. You just try, you just practice with your own student. And when someone come to become a student or try you, what happened? You're gonna put him in a box. You need to grab me like this, in order to feel like that, like that. This goes against the idea of what classical Bujutsu is. That's the first thing. Kono Yoshinori is a researcher. He doesn't really have a master. He pick up everything here and there, and he create his own way, his own style. So the people who come to learn from him, they learn to become their own way, their own style, which is very difficult to teach, you see? Because he is himself in kind of evolution. He didn't find yet, or he find few things, but he's always changing. And that's very difficult for the people who doesn't have the same pedigree, the same, you know, process as him. So they come, they pick up things, oh, this is come from Koryu. No, you need to be clear, very clear on what you do. Because the people who come, they need direction. They need orientation. So when you know your own direction is your own direction, okay, my direction is not yours, for example. But if I teach you, I need to teach you something that makes sense to you, for your future, and if you can use it to become better than me, bravo. So yes, the tendency in Japan is this. The tendency is first to stay in your home with your own student and not seeing over there. And this goes against, first, what I study, against the idea of being open, because the best way to learn and to know about people is to be open. Now, they love this kind of secrecy things to create, you know, some kind of hierarchy between people and to put, because they are scared. When you're scared, you create all those kind of layer. Now you have to do this, now you can't reach, you need to learn from him, and then maybe when you will be good, I will teach you, etc., etc. The tendency actually in Japan is that classical martial arts are dying. Japanese are not more too much interesting about martial arts. Plus, how life is difficult. Yes, foreigners are more interesting. They sacrifice more, they engage more than Japanese. That's a fact. That's a fact. You can see it in any dojo. Of course, Kuroda Tetsuzan have a dojo with pretty much people, but among the people you can see, among the Japanese who come maybe once a week, twice a week, three times, it depends on the dojo, it depends on the individual, foreigner will practice every day. They will even make a living of that. So, did I answer to your question?
Yes.
Thanks. Any question, please, feel free.
Yes, sir. Master Kassel.
Call me Kassel, Master. Well, it's too big.
Why is it, why for you? What was your motivation?
I mean, I was a kid, you know, I see ninja on TV, like when you see Spider-Man, stuff like that, and you want to fly. That was the idea, mainly. And then, dream, childish. And then you go to Japan, then you start to study Japanese, you grow, you change. And I like the movement, the idea behind, to not show anything. To not have any intention, to not be able to, no one can read what you're going to do. The capacity of always adapt, always keep on moving. Actually, it's what classical martial arts should be and was. To always adapt, to not be fit on only one thing. To be like the water, to keep, take the color of anything, but never change your own essence. To be open to any kind of things. But at the same time, to be centered, to know where your center is. So as this idea of ninjutsu, the meaning of ninjutsu, the nin, shinobi, shinoba, seru, etc., have the meaning of course, endurance, perseverance, patience, resistance, and to keep things secret too, to do everything in a hidden way. And jutsu is the technique, so it's not a technique of going fast or doing this. It's always to find a way to go deeper and to work on yourself. Of course, it includes different aspects of like spying, assassination, according to the history. I've studied this in scroll with master, you study also anatomy, you study a lot of things. And I like this. I like what is transdisciplinary and multidisciplinary. Because we have 10 fingers, not only one. And he's got so, and he goes everywhere, see? So that's important. That's what I like. Yes, that's what I like. But I like any style, huh? Through the eyes of ninja. Which means I like no limit as limit. That's what I like. And this is the meaning of, but it's difficult, very difficult, very difficult. A lot of people won't agree. I don't care. But I can argue easily because the knowledge is there, and the history is there, and the proof are there. You just need to take it. But I like any style, not only Japanese. I like Chinese martial art. I like when it's beautiful. I like the choreography. I like music. I like dance. I like, for example, seeing a choreograph of like Michael Jackson and things like that. You know how many times they're gonna repeat the movement in order to fit a certain things and to be on time with the music and the flow. This for me, it's martial art too. I like, for example, seeing someone who is drawing something, the way he takes his calligraphy, the way it's writing, it's martial art. Someone who's working the wood with passion and doing slowly, it's martial art. And what I'm gonna add on this is maybe, for example, a better positioning. Take care of which kind of muscle you're gonna use. If you overuse the right, I'm gonna use the left in order to create the balance. That's the things I'm gonna use more. That's the things I'm gonna add more. So I'm gonna take the best and add it to the best. And the bad I'll let. That's what I think. And if everything is good, even someone evil, even someone bad, might have something good, so I take it and these evil side I leave it for him. But I'm aware of. It's all right. Any question, please? Yes.
You touched the point earlier. So far we've talked about mostly about the past. And you've touched the point of transmitting. How do you see the transmission going to the future? The transmission of martial arts. You've touched that point previously with the Japanese.
Well, I see it's going on. It's something in motion. It's not something stopped. You have this aspect in classical martial art, but in any kind of, it's kaku genzai mirai, past, present, and future. I strongly believe when you study the history, and the history is approved, that everything from the past are using now for tomorrow, and we can be rich of everything we did in the past, or the mistakes of the people, and use it to not to avoid or maybe to attenuate the effect. I think we live in an extraordinary time where we have access to many things, many things, things that most of the masters in the past didn't have access. So it's a shame to not being able to not study, to not going deep. It's a shame. That's what I think. As far as the knowledge and the information is right now, our end, it's a shame to not going deep. We can study many things. We can have access to so many things. So I think the transmission is going on. Now the problem is, compared to the past, it's the number. In the past, it was more about quality, and you didn't have time. It needs to be quality because you have to survive the next hour. So you're gonna work in a certain way. Now, with everything we have, it's more complicated to find the quality. It's more about the number. So. Rather than using also the word, the quality, we can, the substance. People are looking more for the numbers and how it works in a superficial way rather than looking the substance. Substance takes time. So I think the transmission is still here and will be and will always going on because there is always people who try to convey something. Even a little bit, even a drop of substance is a beginning of large substance in the future. You will always have someone who will come to learn, always have someone who come to question, always have someone who's gonna have with an idea, with a little bit of light that might bright, give an orientation, a direction. I believe it works. Otherwise, I won't do it. Of course. I'm in Japan, I'm not Japanese, do you see my face? So if it doesn't work, it works. I believe it works and it needs to work. Yes, because that's how human life cycle is. Otherwise, university, anything, knowledge, you need to be stopped. No, and it works. It's important to have hope, huh? Otherwise, it's important to have hope. Yes. That's the only thing we can have, and it's free. And free. Free and light. Any question, please, ladies and gentlemen? Yes.
In order to improve the transmission, an apprentice can eliminate by practice his perception of the technique or not?
Improve the transmission, first you need to be one with. In order to improve something, improve, you need to be inside because there is this word, you know, improve, which means inside the proof. Lot of work. Huh? So you need to be the proof, the living proof of what you say, technically speaking, to understand, to be also the gate and the window that explain what the master could not explain. We need to see through your movement the proof, and this is also the, go back to the word authentic, because authentic is a proof. Show me how it's authentic. So you need to prove that it works. Right. So you need to be the proof, at the same time, the image, the mirror that reflect the master, because the student reflect the master, like children reflect the parents, the best and the good. Then you have to polish that in order that it bright. Then once you can do this, you want to improve that. You have to keep on going and keep on practice. Problem is always the mindset. With what kind of mindset, what kind of ego, what is the purpose of that? The question of meaning, question of finality. It's always really important. So I think we can improve, of course. As long as we keep things real, as long as we keep things alive, as long as we don't destroy the essence of the message, the nature of the message. The message, you know, is pure. What you can do is to open it more. If it was, for example, the first time he was saying it was just by word, now you use a microphone. And now you use Wi-Fi. Use what you can in order to make it wider, bigger, deeper. If people can't listen, put it in the brain. If they can put it in the brain, put it in a computer, on the smartphone. And if no one uses it, someone one day will find it. That's why there is library. That's why there is so many books. Because one day some people will use it, at least, for sure. Let's hope. Must hope. Is it okay? Any question, please, feel free, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, sir.
The student is ready, the master
open. Yes, yes.
What is the meaning?
It's beautiful. First student, you know what's very interesting? It's a beautiful, even in Zorro, the movies, Anthony Hopkins, when he met Antonio Banderas, he said, there is a whole saying, you know, with that class. When the student is ready, the master. Nice, man, I would love a master said this to me, you know? The meaning is deep. It's not only the student which is ready. It's the master who should be ready to transmit. It's different. It's very different. You know, a student is a sponge. He's not ready. A master arrives, starts to teach him, you don't understand? And when the master, they say, you let me alone with that. I never asked for this. And then, he start to realize when he go through what the master went through, like when you grow adult and you go through same things your parents, etc. You realize that he was right when he said you understand when you're gonna have my age. Right now, for example, Hatsumi-sensei in Japan is always saying this. Now I understand. Now that I reached the age of my master, I understand what he mean. But it's not complete. You know why? Because as long as you didn't find the next one, you need to go through the same cycle, of course, of your time, where the period where you live, and your own context, but through the same situation. And then, when you go through this, you understand what he felt. And at that moment, you can say, I am ready too. For example, if Hatsumi-sensei had met Takama-sensei 15 years before he met him, maybe he was not ready, him. Hatsumi-sensei was not ready because he was involved into something in his own process, and Takama-sensei was not ready to find one and to give him everything because he was not ready. So it's not just the student, it's the master. It's like more than the master, the transmission is ready to get open. It's like the door open. If we put this into a religious, like most of the prophet, if we look Moses or the prophet of Islam or even Jesus, when did they really start to deliver the message? Most of them, when they reach a certain age, for example, in the prophet of Islam, he was 40 years old, already a man. Same for Moses. Moses was a son of a pharaoh, he did many things, and then when he reached a certain, then he starts. You see? There is a process that pushed them to become ready. But they are ready, and they doesn't know. Something come to them, and most of the time they scare about that. What is that? Is God talking to me? Who is that voice? See? And then step by step. So the phrase is really beautiful, and I like it. I would love to know who tell this for the first time, if he was a master or a student. And anyway, a master is a student back in the days. Is that it? Yeah, sorry?
A book.
Yeah, for sure a book. But a book is written by a man, you know? So. I guess it was a master who was a student before. And there is a phrase from Zenami. Zenami is the son of Kanami, the fondateur of Nome. And he wrote a few densho like this, transmission in a book. One of them is called Fushikaden, very beautiful. And one of the phrases at the end, you know, sometimes the end is important. Not because it's the end, it's because it's the opening for something new. He said, Shoshin was Nebe Karazu, which means you should never forget the initial mind, the first mind. the first mind you had when you start to practice, which means you need always to not forget the first taste, the first mind you had when you start a practice, but at the same time to always refresh what you have. What does it mean? Like this, you're always ready to learn, ready to apply. So you need to always keep the student mind, right? Kind of innocent, ready to learn. Because if you're a master, you think you master everything. So it means it's finished. When it's finished, it's like death, you know? It's not interesting. I think you are a master when you don't know you're a master, when you give, and what you give makes sense and give the orientation, but you give it because you have to give it because it was given to you. So you're ready to give it. You know when you know it, you feel it when it's time to give it. That's why you're ready. And when you're ready, the student arrives. It doesn't mean the student will get it. You know you have to give it. That's how the transmission works. I guess by now, maybe in 10 years, I will tell you something else. But based on what I said today, based on what I said today. Any question, ladies and gentlemen? Feel free.
Some years before.
Just okay. Yes. Yes.
Is the act of understanding a dangerous act in martial arts? I mean, when you say, I understand this technique or I understand that, is that dangerous to say that, to think about that, when you can say this? That idea.
Well, first you do it, you apply, and you apply against many people, and it works the same way. At that moment, you can say the technique works like that. It's Mohenberg that said, "I understand how the technique works," because it's difficult to say I understand the technique works. Techniques is a process, a processes of many different generation of people through different time. So the way you do it when you're 20 years old is going to be different when you're 30 years old, etc., etc. Maybe the way you teach this technique to people in Romania is very different when you teach to people who are Spain, and less, more different when you go to Russia or if you go to North Africa or Africa itself, because you have to fit the culture, etc., etc. That's one thing. And of course, the mindset of the people, the psychology, the moment, if you are in an entertained moment, if you are in a transmission moment, if you are, everything is about transmission, even entertainment. So it's difficult to say I understand, because the way you understand now will be different tomorrow. And let's focus on this word, understand. It's under where you stand. So it's the base under your feet, you know, it's the true base, like the roots of the tree. How deep you can see the root of the tree, you know? So understand is more like in an intellectual way. And everything that deals with intellectual, it's more in the mind. Here, you can maybe, you know, understand, and I use the word understand, or let's say you might have a view of how biomechanics works in a mathematic way, physic way, etc., etc. Now, how it applies, that's not theory, it's reality. So once you can match the reality and the theory, you learn something to be more humble. Yes, because you know that, you know, there is a lot of valuable things you can't really measure. The best is to say, this is how I've seen the technique, this is how I've learned it, this is how I do it, and this is how it works. With someone else, it might work like that. It's always very important to keep an opening. It's not academic, it's life. It's difficult to be academic in life, but it's important to put life into academic. Do you understand? That's why I use the word, do you understand? And that's why, for example, you know, in the world of music, you know, they never use the word, do you understand? They say, do you feel me? Do you feel me? It's even worse, because what? Huh? What? What? Do you feel me? It's even worse. But you might say, ah, I see. I see. Another, yes,
yes, John. A few years back, we had a discussion about transmission.
You and me?
Yes.
True?
I guess so.
I don't recall.
And you mentioned. mention, as usually, a lot of things, but one of them...
Which means I talk too much.
No. Which means I have a lot to take in. And you mentioned something very interesting. I think it's coming from the Chinese classics or something like this. Like the water of a river becomes more pure, more clear when the river will receive at least three sources, something like this. Can you elaborate more on that?
Oh, you have better memory than mine.
Forget that.
So for example, as a good student, this is what you should do. First, you need to give me the right references, the book and everything. Yes, yes, yes. I forget. Yeah, transmission, yes. Sometimes you can receive the transmission from different individual, and because who you are, there is always one current who's going to influence you in a deeper way. Why? For many reasons. Maybe because the one who told you have a better heart, a deepest heart, who show you a bigger vision to be more wild. And this will influence the other, which means, for example, it will put more light, more bright, more depth into the other where there is no. And this is true. Sometimes a current can illuminate another one or can even bring life to another one. Yes, this depends, of course, on the way you are too. Don't forget this for all of you, ladies and gentlemen, you practice or not, or if you are engaged to a practice, no matter what the martial art, never forget who you are and where you come from. Because this is what gonna enlighten, make deeper, or even make worse what you practice. This is very important, who you are deep down inside you, what you receive from your parents, your education, then your self-education, and who you are as a person can make what you practice deeper or worse. It's the same for religion, it's the same for everything. So it's always up to you. That's the reason why I said before, you need to study, you need to practice, you need to always to take any kind of opportunity to open yourself. So yes, of course, I strongly believe to that. Then sometimes who you are, your character, you can be very good for the technical part. For the technical. You can explain this very well. But you're not very good to give. You see? You're a little bit... So your technique will be a little bit, you know, the same way you are. Because never forget, the movement, everything you do, to the way you take a drink, is an expression of who you are deep down inside you. The way, you know, if you look, for example, in Christianity, a phrase like the body is the temple of the spirit. Yes, if you're not clean, what about your spirit? Why do you think in religions you do a lot of movement for cleaning yourself, taking care of the clothes, etc.? Because this is a way from the habit to create inside customs to reach the inside. And this is also connected with what we talked just later about the relationship between spirituality and classical martial art. Why the religions get into the martial art. And how can we say if we understand the technique or not. And when a master knows to choose a student. And how to study. See? Everything is connected together. There is nothing separate. Because there is one heart for many organs. It's cool, huh? So it's the same things. See the sea like many, many currents. And sometimes it goes with me, sometimes not. Because we're like that. Sometimes we're happy, sometimes we're not. But there is always a between. That's what we should never forget.
Thank you very much.
Any question? Yes?
You said two questions ago that in 10 years you will give us another answer, but based on... this current answer.
Yes.
But you also gave us the example of Hatsumi Sensei meeting Takamatsu Sensei and then renouncing of all of his previous ways. So how do we know, how do we define a correct way? How do we know that
it's
our way is correct? Not
very,
only in martial arts.
It's a very good question. I didn't say he renounced. I remember.
Changed.
He changed. Does it say, you know, change doesn't mean renounce. Yes, meaning of the word, my friends, and the weight of the words. He didn't renounce. First, you need to make the peace with your past. Because if you want to renounce, it's like you renounce about a part of yourself. You need to never forget that the process that led him to Takamatsu Sensei is a very important process. And then there is many things good on this that he learned. For example, he learned what he should not do anymore. And that's something very important. That's one thing. Second, the change. You have to change. You need to learn how to unlearn. You need to change your habit. All right? But on those habits, there is a lot of things you're going to understand. Why? Because when you're going to see someone who's been through the same process as you, who have the same problem, you need to be able to help him. So you need to use the same language as him. And because you went through the same process, you can help him. Do you understand that? That's one thing. When I said, in 10 years, I'm going to set something different, not completely different, maybe more advanced, maybe more deep, based on this. You know, because we are who we are. We just, you know, try to move forward. So everything supports what can come. Now it's the substance, you know, of this essence. How you're gonna work it, and how to do it. This it's something you're gonna find by yourself, in the way, in the path, by listening everything around, what you already have, etc., etc. And one day, you're gonna have to be to help someone, a brother, a sister, a friend, even in a job, just for a minute. You're gonna have to help someone. And everything you are, everything you did not, confused or not, misled or not, will be a rich thing, a treasure that's gonna be really useful when you're gonna have to help with someone. Maybe just to press a button, just to take a, etc. There is nothing. I mean, it's important to make to accept who we are first, and to make the peace with what we are, and even with the parents, especially the parents. Yes, especially if they are alive. You're gonna be parents one day, or not, but you're gonna help someone. That's what I think. Any question? Yes, sir.
How important is the concept called Hiyoshi in martial arts?
Very important. Actually, rather than a concept, is an aspect of the life, and it came from no theaters, and you have it in life. Hiyoshi in Japanese, it's two kanji. First one, it depends the one you can use the word shirabe, which means to check, to investigate, and the other is maybe the sound or the rhythm. Both make the rhythm or the cadence. So it's how things modulate, move. It can be the heartbeat, it can be what you feel in the atmosphere, it can be the way you talk, the rhythm of your talk, the way you walk. So this is the Hiyoshi. In the music, for example, is everything that deals with the rhythm. But rhythm, there is a rhythm of life, rhythm of the music, rhythm of talking, rhythm of speech, the rhythm on the way you, the rhythm of the blood, the rhythm of the muscle, etc., etc. So as you can see, it's not important, it's vital. No Hiyoshi, nothing. You can say life is rhythm and rhythm is life. So yes, it is important in anything, any movement. And when you teach, for example, the rhythm you take for teaching something, if you have, for example, a year and you have a program to cover, what rhythm? Your rhythm or the rhythm of the people? How can you make match the two rhythm? When you're sick, when you're tired, when you're in good shape, when you're happy, when you have your paycheck, when everything is happy in your life, or when everything is sad, and you have to match with someone. That's also rhythm. That's Hiyoshi or Hiyoshi.
So I guess it's a strong relation with the transmission.
It is the transmission too, because the transmission is based also on the rhythm. When the rhythm is okay, you do it. When it's not, you don't do it. And sometimes there is a rhythm that goes beyond you, a rhythm that you don't control yourself. I do things, I don't know why I did it, but I did it. What you call the subconscious, for example. Yes, it is very important. More than important, crucial. Any question again, ladies and gentlemen? I'm going to take again 2 and 3, and then I'm going to because I'm sure you have many things to do, especially eat. Because the rhythm of eating should never, never stop. I mean,
with moderation.
Any question, please feel free. You know the TV show 24? No? No question anymore? No question. Do you have any question, honestly speaking? If you don't have, it's okay, no.
I won't be hungry.
Yes, do. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
Thanks.
Hatsumi-sensei said at one point that there are three types of martial artists. There are those who try to polish to become the strongest. There are those who try to polish their technique. And there are those who try to polish the heart. So, like, if you could perhaps give the characteristics of each of those ones, and especially what does it mean to polish the heart? Kokoro mijika.
Well, as a scholar, this is the first thing, and as a student, how? First, the way you ask your question. You said, Hatsumi-sensei said that. When, where, and how? I want the correct phrase in Japanese, and if possible, with his word. I mean, that's how a scholar works. So when you, and that's how I copy, study, and practice. This is how I see the relationship with etc. to all your questions. But anyway, I'm going to try to answer. First, when you practice martial arts, you want to be strong. Matter of fact, it's pretty much a male world. You want to become strong because you want to show off. With time, you understand that strength is not enough. You need to go deeper. There is different kind of strength. Then you want to polish your technique, because the best way to get strong is to polish the technique, to work your technique. But at the same time, you understand that you need to have a strong spirit. You need to cultivate the fire spirit or the sport spirit or the fight spirit. And then you understand sometimes on your process that you see some people, they may be not strong, but they have a good heart. And this touch you. And maybe you understand that the strength, actually, it's not just physical. It's spiritual. And then you understand that strength can be love, can be being nice, being good. And then you understand that being weak, sometimes it's a strength. So, kokoro o migaku, it's how you polish your sentiment, your emotion, in order to be emotional, but not into the excess. To be always on the, to try to find the between in everything you do. In the way you talk, in the way you get angry, in the way you express your word, the way you talk to people, try to not hurt them, try to be always on the right position. That's what we call kokoro migaku, because there is no end on that, no end. Being strong, there is a limit. Polish a technique, there is a limit. Sooner or later you become good. Sooner or later you become strong. Sooner or later you have a lot of muscle. But polishing the sentiment, the heart, there is no limit on that. Can't say that Hatsumi-sensei means this. But again, I'm not aware of the Japanese phrase, I'm just guessing. Is it enough? Yeah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very, very much. I hope you have to say thank you. Thank you for taking the time. I hope you enjoy, I hope you learn something, I hope it gives you some details or anything. That's the most important for me. And again, I thank you, the university, and all the professors. Thank you very much to allow me to. Thank you so much. And have a pleasant night.